a limited company? Okay. Two things, right? If you are having a commercial profit through a limited company and you're trading more than 2 years, then you can get entrepreneurial relief, right? And you'll be subject to 10% CGT on that. But if not, then you will be subject to 28% capital gains tax to sell before 1 year.
And that's true for all types of companies, whether it's a trading or a holding.
Yeah, all type of companies. You do get a kind of entrepreneurial relief if you come out of the thing.
So it's as good as actually selling a property or selling shares in your business.
Yeah.
It's treated in the same manner.
Yeah. So if you sell your business, lock, stock and barrel, with properties and everything to somebody, then you can avail the 10% entrepreneurial relief out of it.
Yeah, but sometimes actually you don't sell everything, you sell part of it. Right?
Yeah, so you can still get that. There's a limit up to £2 million on entrepreneurial relief at the moment, I think. Correct me if I'm wrong, you know.
What is the range for CGT at the moment?
At the moment, it's 18% and 28%. So low tax band pays 18%, high tax pays 28%.
And the tax band is determined what your status is at the...
Based on your income, on your self-assessment.
At the point of selling?
Yes.
Well, isn't it the first 11,000 is allowance?
Oh yeah, you get your allowance. Yeah,
so purely contracting point of view, let's say if you have like a trading in a business, like in your company for 3 years, and if you decide to close down.
Yeah.
So if you have like cash in your so that 11,000, you can actually get it as a tax free.
Yeah. So if you close down your business, yeah. So what happens is that you get the 10% entrepreneur relief. So whatever the money is, let's say £25,000 or whatever, you have to pay 10% on that. You don't get that allowance. The allowance is only for personal purposes, not individual purposes.
So but like if you close down your company, it will be like the profit what you earn after closure, it will be considered as a CGT, right?
Yeah.
That CGT, if it's like...
Yeah, that's the reason they give you the relief. And they tax you at 10% and not at 18%. Okay. So you can't claim the £11,000 allowance that you're talking about.
It's £8,000 or
£7,000. But is it still profitable to close the company, like, or
well, yeah,
open a new one if you want to, like...
Ah, you can't do that, yeah? If you do that, if you close the company down, right, then it requires 2 years to, what do you call it, restart again and then claim that allowance again. Otherwise, you'll be taxed.
No, I mean, don't go with the same parameters, like,
yeah.
Like, you can have a different address or anything.
Yeah.
I mean, it's been done.
Yeah, but the name is there, isn't it? You can put your name down. Unless you put your wife's name down, you know, and start a company as a...
No, with like partnership with friends, you know.
Yeah, if your name is there, then obviously that comes up.
Company's house records actually is individually connected.
Yeah.
I've seen people having multiple kind of entries in the same name, opening different accounts.
If you go into company's house website and if you put your name down, and I can actually trace you all the way back to when you first started your company.
Very easy.
So one of my friends had like an identity theft. Because I mean, like with his own account, like
right.
And then he had to close it because, you know, like the bank said, you know, we can't do much. In this
right. Account. Well, that's a different.
So,
yeah.
So, like proper legal, you know, like legal issue, like happened. So.
Yeah, that could happen. But basically, as far as you are concerned, you can be traced all the way back. We all can be. Mm-hmm. And well, the only thing is that, yeah, one more important thing is that. On company's house, please don't give your personal address. You know, as a, if you've got accountants or if you've got anyone else, this, you know, you have two kind of addresses. You have your registered address and you have your sale address, and you also have to give your personal address. The personal address can be the registered address. Yeah? Because anybody can actually go on company's house and locate who you are. Yes. So, it's better to keep yourself anonymous.
Is that critical that we change directors' addresses to the registered business address rather than personal address?
Yeah, it's better. We don't want to know where you live, basically. So I can actually go and trace exactly where you live, and if I can do a lot of things. So. It's better to have it to the registered address.
For the small limited companies, should you have their registered address of your limited company and their residential address, like me, what do in that case?
You have an accountant?
Yeah.
Yeah,
can be changed.
But at least your address is not disclosed.
How do we change that to?
You sell your account in that time. I want to actually use your services, your company's virtual services.
Yeah, right.
You might charge you a few £100 or something like that. But it's better, you know, you can be sure your identity is kept away.
So which address you need to change for that?
The registered address. The registered address, not the registered address, but the direct address, personal address. You can change the registered address also, both of them. Basically.
Change on the company's return form, company return form.
Yeah. So if I go and check Ravi and I go into your company as a Vivaka, I don't want to know that your personal address exists over there.
Okay.
Right? If I know, then I know exactly where you stay.
Yeah.
I can spam you, I can send emails to you, I can send letters to you and all that kind of stuff. So easy to catch.
But if you let's say if you work from your own registered address, so and if your registered address is not your own property,
That's fine.
So how would you like you? Sometimes you claim, right? Like most of the time, you claim the
£4
a week or something, isn't it? Like
you get £16.
Yeah,
£16.
Work from home.
Work from home. You can claim £16 as a
home office
here.
Yeah, working from home.
So if you registered as accountant address as your registered address for your business, then
it doesn't matter.
You can still
every employee can also claim working from home. Even if you're an employee of your firm, you can still claim £2 a week. Or I don't know what the rate is now, but you can still claim maybe more than that. But that doesn't deter you from claiming.
Are they for startups? Any tax credits for people investing in startups or?
Well, not startup, but if you're a sole trader and you actually convert yourself into a limited company, then you do have incorporation relief, right? Now, what the incorporation relief is that as a sole trader, if you have a lot of stock and everything and you're transferring into your limited company, you can claim that as a kind of a loan from to the company from yourself, right? So that's the incorporation relief that they do give you. So, if you have cars and stocks and all that kind of stuff, then the company doesn't have any money. The company is going to say, hold on a minute, okay, you're giving me all this, but I don't have money to give you.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to give this money back to you later on. So you can claim that relief. Yeah.
So
it's
treated as a loan.
Yeah.
And
so
you can charge interest on that to the company?
You cannot charge interest, but it's something that you're just giving it to the company. So you get a kind of a, how do we say, there's a good name to that particular relief. Purely that you're transferring your stock and your car and everything into there.
So in that case, what is the tax relief or advantage? What are we saving or what are we gaining?
Well, you're saving a lot of money because at the end of the day, when you take the money out of the company, what you're saving is CGT.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's a rollover relief. So that is what you're saving.
So if I have a sole trader.
So yeah, if you're a sole trader. And you have you're a sole trader company. Yeah, you have all the assets and you have all the stock and everything and you think all of it. I want to now incorporate.
Mm.
So you start a company, right? The company doesn't have any money.
Mm.
The company says, Ravi, I don't have any money, but I want all that cars in it so that I can do my own business.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll give the money to you later on.
Mm.
Now as a sole trader, what you've actually done, you've actually sold your car and everything to the company.
Mm.
Right? So that triggers a CGT,
mm-hmm.
Okay? But because you get this incorporation relief, the CGT is rolled over. You only pay the CGT when you actually sell your company.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, makes sense? I don't know.
Yeah, but if that company pays back, then there is no.
Yeah, no tax. So the company can pay back that loan back to you. So if it's 30,000, then it can pay it back to you. So virtual FD is something what we started recently was with the large companies, whereby the large companies tend to have bookkeepers, but they don't tend to have accountants because some companies, you know, were turning around 2 million, 3 million, cannot afford to have accountants or financial directors because they tend to cost a lot of money. So what we do as virtual FDs is we actually sit behind and tend to visit clients on a kind of a monthly basis, once a month. Just to check how their accounts have been prepared, are the systems and controls in line. That's something we do before Jay actually. We tend to visit their company and have a kind of a brainstorming with the kind of a managing director in relation to what is happening, how his business is going, how we can help you further in relation to. Because don't forget, all managing directors are kind of loners. You know, they don't know exactly what to do and they always are looking for someone to bounce ideas with. And that's where we actually come in as virtual FDs to help them manage their financial system and also help them grow their business.
So I think that was one good service. When we started business, when we didn't have our own dedicated finance director, we had just a bookkeeper in the business actually. So he used to come every month at the time of month-end closing. And like a finance director in a business would do, he'll go through the checklist with us actually. Because we are at the end of the day technocrats, we don't understand finance enough really. So that was a good service really.
So that's something that we are actually starting. It kind of helps a lot of people. So we've taken on more clients actually. One of our clients is actually a large construction company. Now they were actually making a loss, but apparently there's a construction boom going on at the moment in the country, and apparently now he's turning around £7 million turnover. And he just has a bookkeeper, so he said, "Akshay, can you actually come and help me out? Because I don't know whom to hire and what to do." I said, "Yeah, it sounds good to me." So I actually visit him every quarter, not every quarter, every fortnight, and sit with him and go through all his accounts. And he's quite happy with that kind of service because A, he doesn't have to hire me, B, he doesn't have to pay national insurance on my thing, and I only have to charge him on a daily rate. So both are fine with us both. Yeah?
We want to hear something on pension.
Yeah. Rajita, you want to actually give us a short synopsis? I was going to ask you, but I know I was a bit uneasy.
I actually made a few notes.